Let's work an example to prepare the journal entries in a job order costing system. The Custom Division of Allied Manufacturing had one job in process at the beginning of May. It was job A11 with accumulated cost of $500 and no beginning finished goods inventory. All right, so recognize that this $500 of cost assigned to job A11 is made up of direct material used, direct labor, and overhead applied. We don't know the individual amounts, but we know that it adds up to $500. That was incurred last period. On May 1st, direct materials costing $800 and factory supplies costing $150 were purchased on account. When you buy materials, whether it's direct or indirect, you will increase the raw material inventory account. So we'll add these together for $950, and we will credit accounts payable for $950 since they were purchased on account. On May 2nd, materials were issued to production as follows. Job A11, $200. Job A12, $300. Also, factory supplies costing $100 were issued to production. Notice that direct materials, you must specify what job those are going to, but for factory supplies, you just see the amount. Well, when we record direct material used, we will increase work in process inventory for the direct material of $500 for the two jobs, and we will debit manufacturing overhead for the factory supplies. And of course, all $600 needs to come out of the raw material inventory account since it is no longer in the storeroom ready for use. Anytime you debit work in process, you're going to see that you will update the job cost sheets. We'll do that in just a few minutes. May 10th, paid rent totaling $1,300. When you see that rent is paid, you must say, on what? Well, they tell us. Of this amount, $800 was for the factory and $500 was for sales and administrative facilities. So for the product cost, that is the $800 on the factory, we'll debit manufacturing overhead. The process you would go through is to ask yourself, is this product or period? Well, it's product cost. Is it direct material? No. Is it direct labor? No. Then it must be manufacturing overhead. That is the definition of overhead cost. Product costs that are not direct material and they're not direct labor. For the period cost part, that is for the sales and administrative facilities, you will debit rent expense or perhaps selling and administrative expense for $500. And we'll credit cash. May 15th. Paid factory wages for direct labor as follows. Job A11, 100 hours, $1,000. Job A12, 120 hours, $1,200. The company also paid $1,500 for the factory supervisor's salary. So for the direct labor, there would be a work ticket that indicates where workers spent their time. And it's traced to each job, and for those costs, you will debit work in process inventory. That is the $1,000 for job A11 and the $1,200 for job A12. For the factory supervisor, you will identify that as a manufacturing overhead cost, and you will debit manufacturing overhead. And you'll credit cash for $3,700. Once again, you will update the job cost sheets as we'll see in a minute. On May 15th, manufacturing overhead is applied based on direct labor cost. Estimated overhead for the year is $90,000 and estimated labor cost is $30,000 for 3,000 hours. We're given the information that will help us compute the predetermined overhead rate. We will take the estimated overhead cost of $90,000, divide by the allocation base, which is labor cost, of $30,000, and we get $3 per direct labor dollar. This means that this company believes that their overhead cost is three times their direct labor cost, and they'll assign that estimated amount to inventory as they produce inventory. When you apply overhead, you debit work in process inventory and you credit manufacturing overhead. The amount is $3 per direct labor dollar. And if you go back and look at the previous journal entry, you see that we actually paid 2,200 labor dollars. So this is the overhead rate times actual activity. The amount then is $6,600. Now, if the debit and credit accounts are confusing, you may want to go back and look at the diagrams, because you will find that it clearly says when work in process is increased, it will be for the applied overhead. And if you look at your overhead T account, you'll see that when you have applied overhead, you credit the overhead account. Jobs A11 and A12 were completed. We know that that is going to go into the finished goods inventory account and out of work in process. But we need to figure out for how much. This is where we need to go and look at our job cost sheets. Your job cost sheet, you will want to make sure that you include any beginning costs that were incurred prior to May 1st. Looking back at the very beginning of the problem, we were told job A11 was in beginning work in process and had accumulated cost of $500. There was no mention of job A12. Then, direct material used, if you go back and trace that to the journal entries, $200 for job A11, $300 for job A12. On the 15th, you paid direct labor, $1,000 for job A11, $1,200 for job A12. And now you can apply overhead to each individual job. This is where the $6,600 of total overhead applied needs to be broken down by job. And you can do that using the predetermined rate of $3 per direct labor dollar. For job A11, that would be 3 times $1,000 or $3,000. And for job A12, that would be 3 times $1,200 or $3,600. The total cost for job A11 is $4,700 and job A12, $5,100. Now we can go and transfer these two jobs to finished goods inventory. So going back to your journal entry, since both jobs were completed, we'll add $4,700 and $5,100. And we'll transfer $9,800 to finished goods and take it out of work in process inventory. On May 27th, job A11 was sold on account. The customer was billed at a cost plus 50%. We will need to record two things here. One is the cost of the sale, and one is the sale. Now for the cost of the sale, you will debit cost of goods sold for $4,700, the cost of job A11, and you will credit finished goods inventory. So here is where we move that cost to the expense account. We no longer own that inventory. To record the sale, you will debit accounts receivable for $4,700 times 150%. That would be cost plus 50% of cost, or $7,050. and recall that you will credit sales for $7,050. Final journal entry on May 31st, it says other manufacturing costs incurred during the period are $2,600 for factory depreciation, $1,000 for factory insurance, and $900 for factory utilities. In addition, depreciation totaling $1,000 and utilities totaling $300 were recorded for the selling and administrative facilities. So recognize as you read through this that you have both product costs and period costs in this transaction. Looking first at the product cost, you can see the factory depreciation, the factory insurance, and the factory utilities will be a product cost. They are not direct material. They are not direct labor. So they are overhead. We actually incurred overhead costs totaling $4,500. So we will debit manufacturing overhead. Then to address the period costs, we have depreciation of $1,000 and $300 for utilities. These are on the selling and administrative facilities, so they are period costs. We will debit depreciation expense for $1,000 and selling and administrative expense or utility expense for $300. Notice that the period costs are recorded immediately in an expense account, since they are expensed in full in the period incurred. Our depreciation taken was $2,600 for the factory and $1,000 for the selling and administrative facilities, so it totals $3,600. And for the insurance and utilities, we aren't real sure what to credit. They don't tell us if they paid cash, accrued it on account. They just don't give us enough information. But we know that it was one of these accounts, something like cash, prepaid insurance, or payables. Now that you've recorded the journal entries, let's assimilate the information. Question 2 says, determine the balance in the following accounts at the end of May. Work in process inventory, finished goods inventory, and cost of goods sold before adjustment. Now, normally, from your first accounting course, you would think that the best way to analyze this would be to prepare a T account on each of these accounts. However, what I'd like you to see is that in a job order system, you can simply identify which jobs are still in process or still in the finished goods warehouse or included in cost of goods sold at the end of the period. We can use the job cost sheets to analyze this. So go back in your notes and look at those job cost sheets that you prepared. Job A11 had accumulated cost of $4,700 and job A12, $5,100. And if you look back through the information, you'll remember that job A11 was completed and then sold. So that amount is in cost of goods sold at the end of the period. Job A12 was completed, but there was no mention of selling it. So it is in ending finished goods at the end of the period. We worked on two jobs, and one is in cost of goods sold, and one is in ending finished goods. So when we go back to answer the question, ending work in process inventory is no jobs, so it has a zero cost assigned to it. Finished goods inventory includes job A12 with cost of $5,100. And cost of goods sold is for the cost of job A11 at $4,700. Note that this is before adjustment. So once again, you see that the job cost sheets are the supporting records for the work in process inventory, the finished goods inventory, and the cost of goods sold accounts. Like it happens so often in accounting, it does all add up, and of course, that's what makes an accountant happy. What is the total amount of operating expenses? All right, this is another name for our period costs. And if you go and read through your transactions, you will find that you had rent on your selling and administrative facilities of $500 on May 10th. If you read on in your transactions, you will see that you had depreciation on selling and administrative facilities on May 31st for $1,000. And also on May 31st, you paid utilities on selling and administrative facilities for $300. So we only have three transactions that were operating expenses, and they total out to be $1,800. Question four. How much was overhead underapplied or overapplied during the period? Assume the under or overapplied overhead is insignificant in dollar amount. All that means is it's close to cost of goods sold. All right, to analyze overhead, once again, you'll see me prepare the T account. I'll put my actual overhead cost on the debit side. If you go back through your journal entries, you'll find that you have a debit to overhead on May 2nd, $100. May 10th, $800 for the factory rent. Factory supervisor's salary on May 15th. We applied overhead of $6,600 on May 15th. And on May 31st, we debited overhead for depreciation, insurance, and utilities on the factory for $4,500. These are our transactions for the month of May. And if we want to close this out, we see that we have actual overhead cost of $6,900, and we assigned inventory overhead cost of $6,600. Based on our predetermined rate, this is what we thought we should assign to inventory. So clearly, we have not assigned enough cost to inventory. So we'll call that underapplied overhead. Note that to close that out, you will need to debit cost of goods sold and credit manufacturing overhead. Again, the goal is to get this balance to zero. And finally, we are asked to prepare an income statement for the month of May. Looking back through your transactions, you would find that sales occurred one time for job A11 and it totaled $7,050. Cost of goods sold will be $5,000. That is made up of the cost of job A11 plus the underapplied overhead. So make a special note that when you prepare income statements, it will be for the cost of goods sold after adjustment. This will leave a gross margin of $2,050. We then subtract our operating expenses of $1,800, and we get net operating income of $250. Now, it will be worth going back through all of this, the transactions and other numbers that we calculated to see where these numbers came from. But this helps you put it all together, how this will ultimately end up on the balance sheet as work in process or finished goods, or on the income statement as cost of goods sold. Now it's your turn. You'll want to work some journal entries problems to get practice and get help if you need it.